talking about an absolute legend of our time. Dear friends, this edition of Hyderabad Literary Festival is commemorating three legends, giants in their own field. We have, of course, as we all are gathered here for the commemoration of M.S. Subbulakshmi. We have Chandralekha, 100 years of M.S. Subbulakshmi, 10 years of passing of Chandralekha, the dancer, choreographer, and the recently, in 2016, Shweta Devi passed away. The three legends are being commemorated yesterday. Many of you might have been there. We had an exquisite performance by Bhulan, a tribal group from Gujarat, who performed Shweta Devi's play, The Sun Dayani. And today, we celebrate M.S. Subbulakshmi. Today's program has been divided into two parts. We're really talking today of the drawing of women. Carnatic music is probably put on the world map by this absolute legendary musician. And we are here to celebrate her life, her work. And we will do so with two people who have owned her up. We have the photo journey by Avinash Pasricha, who is known, as we all know, for his excellent photography and perhaps the largest collection of photographs of classical performers, both music and dance. And he has been following M.S. Subbulakshmi and has created a film that we are about to see and present for himself. We will have him talk about his journey with M.S. Subbulakshmi. And then we have Gauri Ramnarayan, who is a theatre person, a musician, a writer, and a scriptwriter as well, who has been with, she's the grandniece of M.S. Subbulakshmi, who has been accompanying M.S. on her various concerts. So she will be giving us first hand on her experience along with the music of M.S. Subbulakshmi. We're very happy that all of you are here to take us through this journey. May I invite Avinashji to come to us on stage and
government giving her a nice package, she went to war, and she you are not going to be able to answer any audio lecture that you are going to see with me. Enjoy this memory that I have. After that, I have visited several members. You just enjoy your audio vision, the photography, and the track, and then the audio.
Yantaru Mahanubhavu, as many as great souls as there be, to every one of them I bow respectfully. Undoubtedly the greatest voice in Indian music in the last 100 years, Madurai Shanmugavidu Subbalakshmi, has made her place in our hearts with countless names that pay tribute to her. Prasanna, the Nightingale of India, Queen of Music, Empress of the World of Music, Kokila Gaan, she is also lovingly referred to as Kunjamma. Born in the temple town of Madurai on 16 September 1916 to Vinay Shanmugavidu and Subramanya Iyer, her mother was her first guru. She imbibed music by osmosis, accompanying her mother to concerts. At the age of 9, she was singing at a gathering in Madurai where she was discovered, leading to her first gramophone recording by HMV. MS, the phenomenon, had arrived. G.V. Venkatachalam, the doyen of art critics, met MS when she was 13. With a voice clear as crystal and an innate musical talent, the little girl, Kunjamma, started her musical career by singing at weddings at 10. She received formal training under Shivamangudi Srinivasa Iyer and many other stalwarts like Arimudi Ramanuja Iyengar, Mushri Subramanya Iyer, and G. M. Rao Subramanya, who taught her the compositions of great Carnatic composers. Kalimudi Samasiva Iyer told her, "Child, you carry the veena in your throat." In 1932, 16-year-old MS gave a landmark performance at the prestigious Music Academy in Madras. After this, she never looked back and went on to become the first woman to be honored with the Nobel Prize in Carnatic Music in 1969, the Sangeeta Kalani title. For the cinema world and cast her in his Silva Sadhana in 1938. MS went on to do 3 more films, Shakuntale, Savitri and Meera, which was made both in Tamil and Hindi. It was Meera that made MS touch the hearts of North India. Prime Minister Jawaharlal Nehru said in awestruck admiration, "Who am I, a mere Prime Minister, before the Queen of Song?" In 1936, MS found another love to rival that of her music in Tyagaraja Sadasiva. They got married in 1940 when she was almost 24. and he nearing 38. Never did a couple fill each other's lives as completely as Sadasiva and MS. If MS made melody, Sadasiva made MS. If music was MS's career, MS became Sadasivam's career. They were together for 57 eventful years, up till Sadasivam's death in 1997 at the age of 94. Bade Ghulam Ali Khan was MS's favorite musician of the North. He returned the compliment by looking upon MS as his favorite musician of the South. He compared her to a musical instrument, saying, "MS, she is our Chennai." He called her Suswara Lakshmi, Sumba Lakshmi. Early in her career, she developed a unique style of singing, highlighting the bhakti element in Indian music. She was a pioneer in recording purely religious verses like the Venkateshwara Balaji Suprabhatam and the Vishnu Sahasranama, amongst others. Time and again, she sang for innumerable charitable causes and donated generously to orphanages, hospitals, and schools. Musician to be featured abroad at prestigious events like the Edinburgh Music Festival in 1963, the United Nations Assembly Hall in 1966, a coast-to-coast tour of the United States in 1977, the Royal Albert Hall, London in 1982, and festivals of India in Paris, London, and Moscow. Ramana Magsaysay Award in 1974 for exemplary service to music and mankind. National awards followed one after the other, the Padma Bhushan in 1954, the President's Award in 1956, the Padma Vibhushan in 1975. She was the first artist and musician to be honored in 1998 with the highest award of the nation, the Bharat Ratna. Sadhana in music became a lifetime mission for MS, putting heart and soul into every raga and every song she sang. Whether it was the rag Shankarabharana, one of her favorites, or any other ghana rag of Carnatic music, she explored every nuance, facilitated no doubt by her superb voice that could cover the full gamut of three octaves. To quote a connoisseur of music, Subba Lakshmi is one of those rare human beings on whom the gods have smiled. The adulation of her fans, the awards, and the recognition did not dilute the innate humility and grace of MS. Gentle, modest, eager to please, no one has loved the human race more through her music. She is brave. greater than her performance on stage. She is truer than her family and professional circumstances. In the end, perhaps, M.S. Subbalakshmi, the musician, will have to be measured in terms of M.S. Subbalakshmi, the person.
Yeah.
frequented at home. It was on the first floor of the office of Kalki, the magazine. And her husband was the manager and later the editor of this of Kalki. So this was housed on the down floor and it was upstairs in the mansion. So anyone who came to see Sadashi at the office is bound to come up and visit them. And she was one of those people who wanted to know what you were doing. She never talked about herself. She was a wonderful listener. I always said she would make a great journalist because she was very good at listening. You know? And one of the persons who frequented her home was P.K. Chidambarana Shumudhiriya, someone who was a great rasika and an interpreter of Tamil poetry, Kambaramayana, Sangha poetry, Kanipada, and so on. She had great delight in whenever he came, and she loved to go to his home on a hill station to Kerala. When he would recite poems, and she would just sit and listen to them. They shared a correspondence in which they wrote to each other about poetry. And she says, and I'm going to say that in English, she says, the poem that you recited yesterday, I keep saying the lines over and over again. I'm haunted by it. Now I can just continue. The great Hindi novelist, Amritlal Nagar, who, you know, his centenary was celebrated last year along with the same year as Ennis. And he sat down and explained the meaning of Meera Bhajanji Ennis before the film was shot. So she had that kind of Vikram Mandali, the kind of association with writers and poets. And how could she not be completely moved by the poems of Rabindranath Tagore? And she could say these lines over and over again before she sang them. When the jasmine bud in my heart, Tagore's poem, when the jasmine bud, when the jasmine wood in my heart wore its first blooms, I offered the flowers to you. For my friend, will you not come? For jasmine wood, your flowers are wilting now. They may scatter at any moment. So speak what is in your heart before it is too late.
Devadasis were disparaged as women of any refuge.
abolished totally in 1938. From very young age, Emma's knew that for her, the road to fame could also be the road to infamy. She spoke very little about those years. They were years of privation, deprivation, social disparagement, humiliations, difficulties, poverty even, and I think great anxiety and fear. Kutunjama, gender exploitation, that's what you use now. The gender exploitation was not a catchphrase. It was a living reality. She was not ready to follow her mother and her sister into the Devadasi way of life. She wanted to be married, have children. She was willing to give up her music to achieve this goal. Now, we ask this question. Was Kutunjama's rebellion, was it fueled by the nationalist movement of the time? The cry of the nationalists for social justice, for caste, gender, was she influenced by that? She heard about it all the time. She saw pamphlets, she met people. This was much before she met in the 1930s. As a child, she knew about it. So did she think that she could rebel because around her women was rebelling? Did she think that she could escape from the courtesan stigma? Is that why she overcame her extreme humility, her traditional, hidebound traditional views, and ran away from home to seek refuge with Tyagaraja Sadashivji? What did she choose it? She really chose him to the many other suitors, of course, rich and powerful. Did she choose him because he was a freedom fighter? Did she choose him because he was a Gandhian and she thought that he would keep his word and never make his promise, he would never keep her? She trusted him because of that. The trust was not his case. What tortures, I asked myself, what tortures did she undergo through the 4 years of living with a married man in his house and becoming the target of vile, vicious, offensive, hurtful, yellow journalists? Finally, Sadashi would marry her in 1946 after his first wife died. Then did she feel as his wife? Subsequently, through her entire life, did she have any other choice but surrender to this dominating? But we can never know, then. We do know that finding social acceptance became an obsession ever since Kutunjama, little one, as she was called at home, noted the difference between her father's family, living just a few feet away, and her own family. He was her mother's tutor. He also supported, closely presented many musicians, obviously, to the Rasika in his hometown, Madurai. His devotion to Rama, Lord Rama, was very deep, and the child, Ennis, constantly talked about him and cherished memories of his Ramanavami Puja. When she got to sit beside him on his side, a little horse drawn buggy, she carried the portrait of Rama to the street. There was a man, and there would be a puja, and she would sit next to her father, and both of them would sing songs like, you know, Rama, 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 and Nityagra doesn't use it, but I have to know. So, one wonder, Engappa Bhaktiman was a great, devoted man. He was a man of devotion. And he'd always say to the captain, her dear. So I think two treasures, Sangeetam, faithful work from her mother, and devotion, from her father, at a very young age, that really shaped her character. Kutunjama was inordinately proud of the fact that her father was a Brahmin, belonging to a so-called pious caste. She overnight, she was ruled by the obsession to be accepted as a Brahmin. She adopted the Brahmin lifestyle with great enthusiasm. What do you say about a society where a woman feels that she's inferior by birth? She has to be somebody else, belong to some other community, in order to find shame on the society. I don't think MS ever saw this mindset really change in her lifetime. Maybe towards her, but not in general. the time actually. Still people talk about, you know, Venus was a Tulsi in the forest, she was a lotus in the slush. I mean, this kind of language is so offensive, offensive to the Venus. The second great influence on the music were the trio of music composers, Yagraja, Swamiji, and Shankar. Now these composers did not create their music for concerts or for the commercial stage or for anything. They made something, became music, and their music was aspirational, even transcendence. So the natural forever influenced by these ideologies in the great songs, Carnatic compositions that he sang for MS, to choose the hybrid of classical composers exclusively was also a real achievement. And so with a deep focus on the consummate Carnatic. MS acted as four things, all connected to the nationalist discourse. The first was Simba Sabanam, 1939, based on Munshi Premchand's rhetoric novel. MS played Sumati, a young wife kicked out of the house by a suspicious elderly husband. She becomes a singer, joins the freedom movement, and starts a school for girl children. Now, for the first time, a young woman from a very new fashion, the Devadas background, came across the idea that a woman could find an individual identity, independence, empower herself, how? By service to others. A mind-blowing experience. Romantic Shakuntale, with the sensational Carnatic musician J. Balasubramanian, to whose concerts women actually bought flowers and jewelry to go to because they hope that you look at them. And this was a Tamil take based on the Kalidasa classic. And this was a part of the nationalist wave of reclaiming Indian literature. In Savitri, she played a male sage, a male character, Narada, very reluctantly, because she wanted to raise money for her husband and my grandfather, who launched this magazine called Kalidasa. Meera, Tamil, 1944 to 1947, identified M.S. Devadasi absolutely with the Rajasthani princess. A hardcore Tamil people being looked at as a Rajasthani mystic poet. Meera's first freedom, her spurning of wealth and seeing the forest, walking out of the palace to join the marginalized, the vagabonds, the waves, the homeless, people of every caste, taking off the roof. Now, these were seen at that time, I think, what I was trying to say was that I don't think it's just the MS who speak and the songs. The song, the film also succeeded because all these things about Meera, played so brilliantly by them, became for the Indians the story of India. India breaking the shackles of the British government. And as the Gandhians fondly hope, it has become the past, also spiritual freedom. Surely we know the parallels in MS's life. Meera premiered in New Delhi with the last Viceroy of India, Lord Mountbatten, as chief guest. And Nehru welcomed Pandey, welcomed everyone as if he himself was so enthusiastic. And Emma said that she didn't say, but we know that Nehru was there, Indira Gandhi was there, Rajiv and Sanjay were there. So three prime ministers watched the premiere of Meera, which I think is very funny. Introducing MS in the film, poet and freedom fighter Sarojini Nayak prophesied that she, cherished by the people as we saw in the film, and that she was proud of the fact that at the same time as in shows in something else, she resigned her title, you know, to create considered a great poet at that time. She resigned her title, 98 of the year, saying, this belongs to the Meera. Even during the shooting of Meera, MS cast her spell. There was no need to gather any crowd or pay anyone. The moment she walked into the street in Vrindavan, singing Vrindavan and Mangal Meera, crowds came and followed her. And the camera records how they call it, the people call her Meera Mata, thinking that 15th century Meera has miraculously reincarnated. Bombay with a beat. And he was listening to her while on the threshold. And he threw the beat and came forward. Then he kept jumping and jumping, rose until he sat right in front of her, looking up at her, unblinkingly, which unnerved her. And that was actually funded over her. No beauty, was in the mandar. That was her reaction. At the Edinburgh Festival, 1996, Albert Hall, she mesmerized foreign listeners, hearing South Indian Carnatic music in person. It proved to be the same there as here. They did not write the music, they wrote the graphic music. The Scots too said, before such art, one can only bow. The New York Times declared, Subbulakshmi wrote the communication without saying any words. Now, marriage to the magazine editor, P. Sadashiv, as I said, opened a new world to young students. Now, this was how she came into a completely different medium, not only the brand medium, but the intellectual, the intelligentsia, the politician, the statesmen and thinkers. And thing is, people keep saying that she sat up close to Gandhi and Vinoba Bhave and they treated this one and that one and sang songs to them and they were wonderstruck by her music. But they forget that she too sat up close to them and listened to them speak. So their ideas, their ideologies, they went into her music and gave her music what it was. Imagine having somebody like Rajan explaining to her, Rajan, who was a mentor, explaining to her Bhagavad Gita or any of the great kinds of music now, or any different kinds of songs. And she was very proudly saying to the writer, he kept coming upstairs to discuss with her all cultural matters that she worked. And that was a matter of great pride to her. Art now became a part of her larger, holistic ideal. It was never art for art's sake. It was never art for people's sake. It was art for reaching something beyond and hopefully taking other people with you on your journey. By your genuineness, by your tone, by your focus, by your commitment. Also learning songs from mystically inclined persons like Shubhendra Bhatti and Dilip Kumar Roy, unworldly organization. Was also to see that music was as much inward as it was outward. As a performer, you have to be outward, you have to project. But that projection has also to go with pushing something inside you, going on an inward journey. That piece, the connection with all these great people helps you to understand the inwardness of the body. That's why I think we talk about her bhav, they say that it stands for something special. We forget the contribution of all the forces that went into making her music so full of emotion and heart. She acquired a vast, multilingual, eclectic, inclusive repertoire. No paper, no notes, even recording. She internalized everything from the smallest level that she mentioned. Because she said, if you looked at a paper or you kept referring to things, then you can't really emote. So that was something that still seems amazing to her students that you. She may not have been her best. No, MS was not at her best when she sang Miss Linda Rahman Tilaki, or a Japanese haiku, or Khalid Ghazal she has done. Certainly not when she sang the English music at the United States. But we cannot deny that she sang them with the same commitment and the same emotion that she gave to her singing for the Vedic Buddha Bhagavan, Kapi Buddha Bhagavan, or the Shri Buddha. So Sadashivam also knew that the real gain was not in acquiring, but in improving. She channeled her earnings to benefits, educational, scientific, technological, medical, religious, and artistic. This unswerving perseverance, along with a very spare and sparkling life, which is such a simple life that's simpler than mine, made the singer that you sign up. But to be human, even for any selection, is never to be free of conscience. When you are conscious, and paradox, you have paradox in your system, having amply demonstrated the mastery over the intellectual and virtuosic elements of pandemic management, which is that all, okay? All the elements of classical music in the 1560s, she could not but regret having to shift towards cartoons and shows for whatever reason. An old critic looked at Chuckle and said, "Ennis speaks with the tongue of angels. But strangely, there is also a lesson in music. This is not the conflict between doubt and faith. This is the restlessness, which is the effort by which Ennis would like to quell the will." I found those lines very interesting. As soon as they became partners in life, Kardashian ensured that she got the best tutoring, advanced training from the master, 7th century Vaidya, arguably the greatest Carnatic musician of the 20th century. But Zamindari was not happy about the direction he took with Kardashian, but he then worried. He minimized her dramatic virtuosity and maximized her reach with devotional songs. Shlokam, Subrabhat, Sahasranams, Reclaim, Pallavi, Tanam, and Swarapayavas. Bhava replaced the speed that she revelled in. Somebody could say, sure, he made her a national cult figure, but she would have been free to discover a different kind of music, a deeper kind of music, without the responsibility of having to sing for Mahatma Ji's and Neta Ji's and Swami Ji's and Tata Birla Ji's to the audience. But she had to follow her husband's plan of elevating people to the music they understood. And she also appreciated it, she agreed with it, but there was a tussle and this paradox. She wanted to prove herself as a great Carnatic musician. That was her identity. Then she could not anyway deviate from the song list that Kardashian supplied for every single concert, which she had to follow meticulously. There were joyful moments too, as an MS joined her daughter Radha and my mother Anandi when they learned Bharatanatyam from Guru Ramya Malik. There is there are 22 pictures, photographs of a series of photographs of a particular song published in the movie. She did no dancing. But I don't know from where who she learned. Then Peter Sharp, a voice expert from the United Kingdom, exclaimed, "She uses her voice like an Olympic athlete uses his body." Astonished. I wanted to hear a short extract this Olympic athlete metaphor. Hey, Shankarabharan.
अपने आप कौन सोच कर चलना मुसाफिर या ये ठगों का काम And then when she got me, she explained the verse that Sochkar chalna musafir is a musafir is going to everybody in the world. Sochkar chalo, be watchful, chalna musafir. Ya, thago ka gaam hai. Ye thago ka gaam the thieves are actually the five senses. And she explained it for a long time and I think I fell asleep. So this was, MS was very keen or keenly aware of her music. She dismissed her as a young popular singer. Others faced her with help Others thought that M.L. Vasanthakumari was original and adventurous, so she was an everything else. It was M.S. in envy then, but it was a matter of great grief to M.S. that the sheer effort, the brain work, and the play of intelligence that went into her music remained unthreatened. Nightingale, they called him. Do I sing like a bird? So she would crumble actually. Surely this centenary is a very good time for us to go beyond beatifying, deifying, sanctifying, and calling us God as an angel, and go beyond the building of myths and focus on the immaculate concert artist that she was, the classical artist she was. Identify her method, examine her style, discover her musical vision, analyze her contribution, which enriched I think we can all draw inspiration from the Mississippi. which is sound, definitely, certainly, I know this, laughter. She sang it with the idea of equality, liberty, and humanity, those old ideas. And in a time of great violence, distress, and bloodshed,